Thank you very much for the invitation, and I'm very glad to be here to start this morning with a presentation about integrated care. I had the honor and the privilege to be coordinator of INSUPC. It's about integrated and supportive care. It was a European-funded project, and it ran until 2016. In the afternoon, I will tell a bit more about how the project was exactly running, but now I would like to tell a bit more about the content. And gradually, I will also show a bit of the results of the project and also give some lessons, or at least lessons learned, that we can apply for the future. But first, I would like to start with a little bit of introduction into the topic of integrated care and also the connection with palliative care. As you see, for the next years, we also have funding for a palliative sedation project, a bit a different field, but it's quite a big topic in the Netherlands and also in the countries around us. And so I also hope to work on that for the next few years. But also still we are continuing with integrated care, because I think integrated care is a sort of theme or topic that will be on the agenda for the next years. And I think the main challenge will be to connect all kinds of services and initiatives together to serve the needs of the patient better. What we often see, and I will also go into that, is that care is fragmented. And I'm already glad to see that in your slides is partnership-driven and multidisciplinary care, which is a very basic requirement for integrated care, I think. But much more work in this field is to be done. And I hope to shed a bit of light on that from our research. So is it a thing to seek for? Is it worthwhile to strive for? What is it actually? What are we talking about? There is one general definition of Goodwin, who did a lot of work in integrated care in general. Integrated care can be defined as an approach that seeks to improve the quality of care for individual patients, service users and carers by ensuring that services are well coordinated around their needs. I think this is a sort of basic thing. And then we are talking about the right care at the right place, at the right moment, by the right caregiver. I think we can all imagine some patients or people in our own family who were suffering from advanced illness and who were actually also suffering from a lack of coordinated care around their needs. And it's not so difficult to see, for example, how hospitals sometimes can be disconnected to community care. And also, I think the connection with social care can be much improved. And before I start about models and organization, I think it's always good to keep in mind that the eventual purpose is the better care for the individual patient as we know it from our daily practices. This whole integrated care movement actually started in the 1990s. I don't ask you to read this whole slide, but Wagner is an important name. He was sort of founder of the chronic care model. It's still used in elderly care. And I think an interesting connection that they made was community resources with health system and organization of care. And a lot of projects have been built around this model in the past, from the 1990s onwards. And some things they found, I showed you a meta review of 77 reviews, so a lot was going on about that, and we don't go into detail, but I thought, as we have many researchers here, I can put in some research as well. So beneficial effects were found, like self-management support and delivery system design, but also, and this is for me was quite an eye-opener, that there are also many reviews who indicate that actually it's not the design or the system as such, but the human factors around this system that in the end will show if it works or doesn't work. So there is a need for appropriate resources and acceptability of the intervention of integrated care. We see this with palliative care, for example, in our hospital in Nijmegen in the Netherlands, that some patients don't accept the term palliative. It's difficult for them, and also actually for some caregivers, because at the moment you start using palliative, it means, or in their ears, that sort of they are finished. And so these kind of acceptabilities are also there in cultural things. And we also try to find a way around that. I don't know how it is here, but in our hospital, this was quite a theme. Preparation of healthcare providers. For example, we think about medical specialists in our hospital who still need to be opened up for palliative care approach. It is improved quite a lot, but there's still a lot of work to be done. And we still see many cases in practice that are, then we think, what's happening here actually? and support of patients. So human factors are actually very important here. And having said that, I also need to say that integration is a sort of multifactorial thing. So I like this rainbow model, which actually says that there are more aspects on integration, like the clinical integration at the basic level in the care for the patients. That's also about how professionals work together, how organizations work together, and actually also what conditions and possibilities are available from the health system level. And I worked in that in the Netherlands, and I was in a working group for financing of palliative care, and I tell you, it was not easy, because palliative care is running through actually all systems, from primary care to hospital care, social care, and these systems are organized like this in the country and in the system, but the patient goes like this. And so we need to be able to support and facilitate that. This is at the health system level. And if you make the connection to palliative care, I think, for example, the early assessment, which was so a lot in the literature, is a good example of clinical integration. I will come back to that a little bit. Multidimensional care, multidisciplinary teams, but also the cultural integration. I think this is an important one. The definition of palliative care says neither to hasten or postpone death. Well, this is already an ethical discussion, but also integration of norms and values. What is important in palliative care? Who is really supporting this whole patient approach? Or are we still doing a sort of biomedical approach where one doctor takes the organs and the other one takes more care for the mind? Or are we really integrating it? And also at the system level, in the Netherlands, we worked a lot, and I also know it from Ireland, about a sort of national program. And I think these are really, really valuable initiatives. And I think in the coming years, much more will be seen of this. Last week, we had our Dutch Congress, and our health minister announced that the national program will be continued, not only until 2020, but even longer. So we were very happy with that. And I think it's needed to get palliative care also at the national level, awareness campaign for citizens, and all these kind of things that are there. What do we know actually about integration and palliative care? So, for example, how we started in our project was with the observation that many people have avoidable transfers, potentially avoidable transfers to hospital in the last phase of life. I'm not sure if this is totally true, but it was at least said that half of the emergency department of these kind of patients, I would say, seems to be avoidable if the care at home was provided well. But also, a relation between symptom burden at home and the relation to hospitalization was also made. And there are many more articles and literature can be found around this. So transitions are quite a lot there. And the question is, if you organize palliative care well, if it's really needed to have all these transitions in the last phase of life. In Holland, we have a lot of primary care. I know in England is more a lot of hospice care, but still I think hospitalization, if it is avoidable, it's not always avoidable, but I think more can be possible. And in all of this, I think it's important to see that it's not a sort of we against they, them, but also how you collaborate. And we see, and I did a project on the connection between primary care and hospital care, we also see a lot of cultural differences, how people work, how people look at patients. And here are some aspects that general practitioners said are difficult for them when they care for patients in palliative phase at home. For example, the communication, not only with families, but also with other professionals. The options that are available at home, often less technical and specific than in a hospital. Still, if you want to have a patient treated at home, you need to deal with that. How do you do that as a general practitioner at home? The support and coping with patients, families and patients, a rescue culture. So a lot, that's coming back also to this emergency department. So in case we don't know anymore, we send them into the hospital and see what they can do. And they are there at the emergency department and also don't know what they need to do. So we have also from our palliative care team in the hospital quite some cases that we run to the emergency department to see what patient is there, how he came there. There is no treatment plan, or at least it's not really communicated. Information transfer is difficult sometimes still. And then you have a patient at the emergency department. And what are you going to do with it as a palliative care team in the hospital? And also the awareness of approaching death. Less and less, but still I think there are many patients who are not really well informed about their diagnosis at that moment and the progress of the disease. And a lot of work in our palliative care team is about informing and telling to patients what's actually happening to them. So I saw a few nice examples and I put some on the slide. This one I found in heart failure, which is, as you see in our project, a small group that is in the scope at this moment of palliative care. But what they did very nicely is how the care is organized around the patient and the loved ones. And I think psychosocial support is there, a healthcare staff, and I would say also palliative care is in the second line, but also cardiology, of course. And it's also about how services and facilities are connected. And the second one that I want to show is from cancer care. It was made by Bruera in the United States. And he said there are actually three basic levels of integration. And one is that you have the cancer treatment, and just when you need a bit of extra advice, you call someone in. This is a bit the solo practice model, and if you do it a bit more advanced, it's the Congress practice model. The question is, when do you call someone in? And is it too late, too early? What kind of expertise do I not have as an oncologist, what I need a palliative care team for? You get all these kinds of discussions. In the Netherlands now we have a sort of obligation that each hospital that wants to do cancer treatment should at least have a palliative care team available. So now we see that palliative care teams are popping up. Still, we need to see what are they doing, what is the knowledge that they have, what is the expertise that they have. Can we also put some conditions there, like you should have done this and this course or postgraduate course. These are all coming up questions. And then in the end, I think how you integrate it, how you really have one team. And this is still, I think, a level that needs to be achieved, but the ESMO did a lot of work in that. We also have a label as an ESMO hospital to connect palliative care and oncology, and still we know a lot of things need to be done. And then finally, a third example I wanted to show is the integration of a GP and a palliative care specialist, that also at home, when the patient is at home, the GP is still able to call in palliative care expertise. It's not only about hospitals, and I don't know exactly how it is in Ireland, but in Holland we have palliative care teams who can also work in the region. At this moment they are mostly called in by telephone, which has quite some restrictions, and we hope to make a sort of transition that these teams can also visit patients at home much more than they do now. We have some pilots and experiments, but I hope personally that that this can be much more common, that the expertise that we have can also be transferred to the patient's home, not only by telephone. And this is sort of model that you can use to see how we can integrate that. It's not that, as someone said in the Netherlands to me, that we can that we have to transfer the patient from home to another facility where palliative care is delivered, but it can also be that we just call in palliative care expertise much more and much more systematical. So this is a slide that I don't ask you to read, but you can see the colors, and this was made by David Hui from the United States, and it's recently published in CA Cancer, and that's quite I thought it was quite a nice review of the evidence we have for palliative care and the early integration in oncology. And this is really, most of it is hospital-based, but the green things show that there's quite a lot of evidence already coming up, and more studies are done in that field. And mostly it is the connection via the outpatient clinic. So outpatient clinic is able to see patients earlier, and also then you have the possibility to make more and better treatment plans around the patient and make some end-of-life scenarios. So what could happen and what could we do in this case or what could we do in that case? And I think this is very interesting, and this is mainly done at this moment in oncology. So I don't go through it, but it's often nurse-led service, and it's often related to outpatient clinic in the hospital. Then you would wonder, what do we have in the field of non-cancer? And I must be honest to say, not so much in the research point of view. We had some good studies from Irene Higginson from the UK, but they are also a bit older yet. But they tried to, for example, in the mastery of breastlessness, they tried to do a randomized trial, and they found that patients were better able to cope or to master the breathlessness. And also they did something about multiple sclerosis and the integration of palliative care service and complementary care, also in a randomized trial. And actually the results were quite interesting. And in Holland we also did, for example, a study around COPD and also how to detect these patients, because it's much more difficult to see when a COPD patient is palliative or what is the prognosis than in the case of a cancer patient. And this all most times also comes back to us. How do we identify patients? When are we starting up a palliative care approach? And I will come back to this later a bit. So I think in this field, still much more can be done, and it's less developed than in cancer care. But also there are good, promising findings that integration of palliative care can be beneficial for the patient. If we look at the costs, I don't want to look so long at the costs. Most studies are a bit related to hospital care, but there are also good findings that the early intervention and the calling in of palliative care teams and what they exactly bring can be beneficial also from the cost point of view. We have a PhD study in the Netherlands next week. They have the defense that showed that the costs are lower when a palliative care team is involved. And actually there was a study in the JAMA 2 years ago, and a very nice review that also looked into that and also found that the costs are lower. So from a policy point, I would say this is a very interesting finding, because it shows that maybe palliative care, once you develop it, it's able to not only cost money, but also save money at the health system level and at the hospital level as well. Now I would like to spend a bit of time to introduce our project, because one of the questions from the organizing committee was, can you tell something about the project in Europe and what are the common findings in Europe about integration of care? And we had quite some countries and organizations involved, like the Radboud, but also Hungary, Page, Navarra, Spain, Lancaster, Leuven in Belgium, Bonn, Germany, and then we had the WHO, and then we had the Mount Sinai Hospital in New York as well, and the EAPC. If you are interested, you can find a page here to download the book where we describe some of the good examples, and I was privileged to do this together with Sheila Payne, who I just saw is also just in the room. So this is a very nice book if you want to have a bit more detail about this topic. I told a little bit about the problems we have, but actually we wanted to go a bit to see what are the organizational models that are there around in palliative care in Europe that try to integrate palliative care. What is the role of care networks? What is the role of treatment pathways? And also in a European project, we should be aware of having a sort of blueprint, because we also feel that the local situation is very important and very determines in the end what is a successful model of integrated care. So in Holland, it will probably be different than in Ireland, but it doesn't matter. We try to find some general conclusions and then adapt it to the local situation. So what definition did we use? Actually, we said that integrated palliative care brings together administrative, organizational, and clinical aspects in order to realize continuity of care between all the actors involved in the care network of the patients. So we wanted to know who is actually active in the care network of the patient and how do they work together. And then it's clinical, but it's also how you organize it. So in this way, the project also has an eye for organization. And also we thought, is it only about terminal care, or are there also good examples who try to integrate palliative care earlier in the disease? And how do they do that? And how do they support the last phase of life? And not only the caregivers, the professional caregivers, but also the informal caregivers. You don't need to read this. It just provides an overview of what the study was about. Basically what we did, we approached about 6 initiatives in each country, in 5 countries. So in Belgium, the UK, the Netherlands, Hungary and Germany. And in these 5 initiatives, we each sort of selected 5-6 patients. And we did interviews with these patients 2 times. And also we did interviews with the caregivers in this initiative. It could be a hospital, it could be a hospice. It could be a primary care. It didn't matter so much, but what we wanted to know if they are really connecting services together and if they really try to provide integrated care. And also we had interviews with the family caregivers of the patients. We tried to scope at three disease groups: cancer, chronic heart failure, and COPD. And this is basically how it looked like. So in each country, we had about six initiatives, a bit less in Belgium. And in these initiatives, we tried to have an idea of what is the care network of the patient. So in the end, we had 19 initiatives. In these five countries, we had 157 patients, 88 informal caregivers, and 142 professional caregivers. The professional caregivers were not personally interviewed. They were in a sort of group interview settings. And for example, just to show you a little bit of a picture, and I will come back to these initiatives a bit more, is a care network in the Netherlands that runs from a hospital. You see many white coats, but also primary care doctors are there, and they have a sort of nurse facilitator who runs across the region. And another example was Hospice at Home in the West Cumbria. This is a hospice without a building. And what they do, they try to connect in the area, which is quite a rural area, the services together. And a third example came from a home hospice initiative in Pécs in Hungary. In the end, just to show, if you look at the number of patients included, you see cancer patients were most of them. And I can tell you, we really tried to have COPD and heart failure initiatives in patients, but we didn't succeed. So we had, for example, one in the Netherlands that stopped after a year because they were just... They couldn't make it. And COPD was already a bit better, but you see a lot of variations, and cancer is still the main dominant place where the services are developed for these kinds of patients. Here you see a little bit of characteristics of the patients, like the age, the gender, the palliative outcome skill we scored, and it showed they have quite in the score, and I don't go into that, but you can see these were patients that were not in a terminal stage. They were just quiet. They were, for example, not by definition bedbound. So we were able to capture them in a bit earlier stage, and we were actually happy for that, because if you are earlier, then it's easier or better to make an integrated treatment plan or to follow them over time. And most of them lived at home. Yeah, for example, what kind of caregivers are around? It's quite varying, but we see also some differences between cancer, COPD, and heart failure. And we see actually that a specialist palliative care physician, it's mostly there in cancer patients and much, much less in other type of diseases. Still, if you look at relationship, it's a bit a lower value, which means that it's actually better. So patients were quite happy or satisfied with the care they received by their palliative care physician. We also saw that with the specialist palliative care nurse. And interesting is, and this is not the topic for this lecture, but family care, for example, was involved everywhere to a quite high extent, which you would expect, but also that patients were really, really happy and satisfied with the care they had from their family caregivers. So I also think that integrated care is turning a bit the doctor-based model upside down, and maybe the first contact point will much more be the family caregiver. But maybe this will also come in the afternoon lecture more in detail. So just a bit of statistics, if you like it. But what we saw is that palliative care physician was so basically involved in cancer, much, much less in other disease groups. And also we saw quite some differences across countries. It was not our say I intend to make a country level analysis, because we didn't have so many initiatives per country, but already we saw that, for example, Germany, actually this was the most outstanding. They have quite a lot of specialized palliative care, and other countries less. And now I would like to go a bit into the interviews that we did with the patients and to see what came from there, what we learned from that. And first we studied the continuity of care. And we distinguished relational continuity. We studied informational continuity, how the information is transferred, and also the management continuity, who is coordinating the care and the management around the patient. And patients reported positive experiences and negative experiences. And I start with the positive. For example, they appreciate the close relationships and the regular contacts with a small number of healthcare professionals. And I think this is really a strength of palliative care, that they are able to show up with the same face to the patient. And this is what patients appreciate. And this is exactly what's a bit under pressure in healthcare in general, that patients have to deal with many professionals, and each time when they go to an outpatient, they find another doctor. And in palliative care, they were very happy with experiencing a relationship with their doctor or their nurse. And professionals also paid attention to the person behind the illness. And I think this is really also in the heart of palliative care, the whole person approach. And this was also reported back from patients. And patients were known to professionals. The professionals had an idea of who this patient was in front of them, what is their life story, and then it's also easier to develop a treatment plan. And also they were available in case of needs. And this is a bit a double meaning, because it means that we see in particularly in palliative care that doctors sometimes give their mobile phone numbers to patients, their email addresses, and are sort of available all the time to their patients. But the other hand, we also see that nurses and doctors can be getting overburdened because of that. That's what I say, it's a bit a double blessing. So for the patient, it's very nice, but on the other hand, for the professional, it can be burdensome. And there is not really a good system of continuity of care, which is a bit more formalized, as we saw in our study. Maybe you have it, that would be great. Negative experiences, time and energy to build new relationships, what I already said, many new incoming professionals, also in the homes of the patient, don't underestimate that. It's not only that they are in a hospital bed or a hospice bed, but also in their homes, and people come in from outside into their own trusted place, which is quite infringing sometimes, but also can be tension for the patient. Sometimes they did not know what they could expect, so people are coming in, who is who and who is doing what. And I think there the family caregivers are actually taking the wheel and steering what's happening. And also we saw the role of the general practitioner is quite different between countries, but also between initiatives. Some GPs are very proactive and are there for the patient, and others are more laying back and see what's happening. There is quite a difference what we saw. Uncertainty can be there for patients quite a lot. If we look at the information, it's important that patients experience trust and also correct treatment decisions. Of course, as professionals, this is also what you want. But we also saw sometimes a lot of confusion. And a weak point was that the transferring of information between healthcare professionals, between hospitals and primary care, it's limited, it can be late, it can be lacking in details. And in the end, then there is no generally agreed treatment plan. And when there is a crisis or something happens which needs acute action, then it's not clear for the people involved what should be done. And this was something we found as a weak point. And also I must say that at the health system level, with all the new regulations about privacy, which are good to some extent, but also sometimes they prevent that healthcare caregivers can divide and allocate the information properly. And especially for palliative care, which is going over the borders of organizations. So within an organization, it's okay. Within a hospital, you can have the records shared. But if you want to involve a GP, then actually you need to decide each time again what information will be given to whom and what are the sort of possibilities there. And this is an ongoing discussion now for quite some years, and this is also really clear from the patient point of view that it's a problem. So negative experiences were quite there. Professionals that were not well informed, patients that had to tell their stories over and over again. It seems sometimes that professionals did not have regular contact, but maybe sometimes they had, but it was not visible for the patient. Information could be contradictory. There were worries sometimes even about the quality of care. And yeah, what I said in the last point, that patients and family caregivers are the agent of their own information. And some people can handle that very well and some people cannot. And this is a bit of a problem. If you have a family caregiver who is able to handle that, then it can still go smooth, but sometimes it's just crashing and that's really a problem. So extra responsibilities actually for patients and family caregivers to connect and get things together, and still extra roles and still sometimes uncertainty. Then we go to the management. Patients want to be seen as a person, and they were really able to see when multidisciplinary care and whole patient care was delivered. And this is what they also saw, as I told you, as a difference between the hospital or the general care and the palliative care. So palliative care brings a good thing there. And these multidisciplinary teams, they bring a very beneficial thing to the patient, and we should not forget that. So many things what I say now maybe have room for improvement, but at the basics, this is something very well done by professional palliative care caregivers, and I would say also volunteers. So connection and coherency. A few words about the family caregivers, because they are the coordinators often. They monitor the care, they arrange appointments, they do some basic nursing activities as well. And I think also in the whole health system change, they get a much bigger role. If patients are less hospitalized and getting more to the home, then the informal caregiver, the family caregiver, gets a bigger role, but they are not always prepared for that. So we saw that they get this role gradually more and more extensive, but also we saw that even palliative care initiatives were not always able to support them well, and also that their needs may not always be recognized. Yeah, some details from the caregiver interviews, the professional caregivers that we did in the group interviews in the initiatives. So it's very interesting to sit there. So in my case, I was chairing the Dutch groups, and to see also how they look at this integrated care. And we talked with them about content of care, the importance of sharing a proactive multidisciplinary care approach, but also the difficulties that they envisage there. The patient flow, how you can have the patient well managed throughout the disease. The logistics of the information, but also sometimes a lack of resources, and not only in a country, but let's say even in Holland we experience that. For example, the availability of medication out of hours is sometimes still a struggle. And you go, you try to make connections with the pharmacy, and sometimes, like Dormicum, it's difficult to arrange what you need out of hours. And then you need to go to another pharmacy. And of course, the hospital pharmacies, they have it, but the smaller pharmacies in the country and in the region, often it's more difficult. So this was one thing that we saw in Holland. And maybe you experienced things like that as well here, I don't know. But we also saw that the activities of these palliative care teams are often limited to a sort of core team, as we called it. So then you know each other well, you see each other on a regular basis, like a multidisciplinary meeting every week or every 2 weeks. But there is also a sort of extended network. And we also had people from home care at the table, and they didn't know who the palliative care team was actually, and the other way around was the same. So then we see, if we go a little bit outside of the basic team, there is still a lot of things that are not known. And in this way, we did it by asking the patient or the family caregiver, who is in your network? And then we were able to move beyond the basic palliative care team and also say, well, just have a hospital doctor there, have home care nurses there. And then you see that they really don't really know each other so well. And this was for me an eye-opener, because working in an academic center, then you think, well, we have everything here, we have all the knowledge. But if you do one step outside, then you see that there is not so much connection, really, sometimes. And this was also a good lesson for us and for me. So integration takes mostly place in a way that we want to spread the news. We want to say how well we do in palliative care, what the good basic view we have on patients. But what is actually lacking is that there are standardized pathways, that there are appointments, that there are good agreements, and that in that way also patient pathways are managed. And this can still be much improved, I think. So what lessons can be learned? So this is a bit the research that we did, and I hope you get a bit of an idea of what we did, what we found, also what positive effects there were, what sort of negative effects. And these were all, what we tried to do was to select, say, front runners in the field of integrated care service delivery. So we really know the initiative most times, and they are known in the countries where we live. And still we see all these kinds of struggles and hurdles. So the first one that I saw, and that was quite, for me, an eye-opener, was in the hospice in Cumbria. And I would say the lesson is be creative. They had a lack of funding to build a big house, a big place for the patients. And then they thought, why should we put all our money in stones? We can also maybe provide a service and have some nurses or doctors traveling around in a bus and go to the place where the patient is and connect with the caregivers there. So actually they turned it upside down when they had a lack of funding. And looking at the needs of the population, they came to another way of service delivery. And I thought, this is a good lesson. So sometimes you need to be creative. And sometimes you also need to be creative to look around the system, how you did it and how it was used to do it for 10 years. Sometimes you need a bit of fresh eye. And number two is integrated care for me is about connections. And it's also, it was here very nice, building partnerships. I think connect, build a network between home, hospital, nursing homes. We have quite a lot of nursing homes in the Netherlands. They have a lot of expertise in palliative care, for example, in dementia. But the connection still can be much, much better. We have we had an initiative from close to Rotterdam in the Netherlands, where they has this have this nurse coordinator who sort of connected all the services around and also visited patients at home, and it worked very well. But the backside is that once I think this nurse coordinator will retire, who will be the next one, and will this person be as good as the previous one? So this is a bit the backside of the informational model. So it works very well if you once you set it up and you have really devoted and committed people. But what will happen when they leave? The good thing is, at least in Holland, no big bosses. So we try to approach each other on a sort of, not in a hierarchical way, but on a sort of democratic way. And it works quite well. But it's also a bit culturally dependent, I think. So this is the example. This is close to Rotterdam. And then we have also another example where they also did that in Page. They started with a home hospice about 10, 15 years ago, visiting patients at home. Then they started the consultation team in the hospital, started an outpatient clinic, and they also tried to connect these services and also to share employees between the services so that they have a sort of good connection all the way. And I think this is a very nice example. Lesson three, adapt to the local situation. For example, in Germany, it worked very well to start from a hospital with a palliative care unit and then go outside the hospital. The problem is sometimes that they took over the role of the general practitioner at home. And then the question is, who is directing the care at home? And this is what we also saw sometimes as a bit of a worry in the Netherlands, where we have strong primary care and they don't want to take they don't want the palliative care teams to take over their patients. And this is a bit also how you deal with specialized palliative care and how it connects to primary care. In Belgium, they have a home care pathway within the home care. The home care nurses decide together with the physician if a patient is on the pathway. And at that moment, sort of extra services start to begin. And it works quite well there. And in our hospital in Nijmegen, we have an integration of the pain and the palliative care clinic. So we are able to fly in pain specialists at the moment when cancer pain is getting really problematic and they can do blocks and everything. What we are trying to set up now is how we can go outside the hospital and connect more and better with primary care. Lesson four involved the mother of the king. We have a king and the mother of the king is very much involved, and she's also an elderly lady now, much involved in palliative care. She visited our palliative care congress a few years ago at the launch of the national program, and it attracted a lot of attention and a lot of political goodwill. And it really helped to stay tuned and to get also resources for palliative care research, for initiatives, for implementation. And actually, so last week we had the health minister, and also this is sort of continuing story now. And I don't know how it works here with your All Ireland Institute. I think Ireland is a republic, but in this case, in the Kingdom of the Netherlands, it worked very well. And we were very happy to involve the Queen. And lesson five is build regional structures. We all had it already, actually from the 2000s onwards, that we have regional networks. I showed you one example in Rotterdam. We had 66 overall the country. The problem with all these networks is that they work very nicely locally, but they hardly have any staff. And they have, for example, 1 2-day nurse a week. So if you really want to make it a bit bigger and to extend, and when when it gets successful, then you don't have the resources to go further. So what we are doing now is to make it more connected to other networks to connect it more to the academic centers, to also to promote research more. But also they are reorganizing now a bit, and that's also good. But I think at the basic level, it's good to have regional networks, and they are able to carry out a lot of coordination around this region. And for example, it helps us also to implement the Dutch variant of the gold standard framework, where GPs and local caregivers are connected in, let's say, monthly meetings to discuss palliative patients or potentially palliative patients. So it really helps to have a sort of infrastructure for that. Number six, what we did recently, build a quality framework. And it was also a bit written down in the book of Building Integrated Palliative Care from Gomez Batista from Spain. A quality framework says basically what is good palliative care and what are the requirements for that. And by having this sort of done at the national level, we now have the challenge to implement it at the local level. But at least it's written down and there's a lot of consensus. It was not at the first moment, but there were a lot of meetings around that, also with medical specialists, with GPs, with nurses, and all together, all these professional groups, they sort of agreed with the quality framework. So all this preparation work, I hope, will have spin-off in the future when we can start to implement it locally. Transition, a professionalized paradigm where the doctor is in the lead to a much more people-centered healthcare where the patient, but also the family caregiver is in the lead. I think this transition is happening. It's also the question how we deal with that. I said a bit about it before. It is also a challenge how you organize it really around the needs of the patient and the caregiver. This is quite a funny one that I found also in this paper of David Yui. And actually, basically, it says that the challenge of timely referrals. And referrals, I don't mean that the patient needs to be transferred to a specialized palliative care doctor or nurse, but also that it comes into the view and comes into the treatment plan of a palliative care approach. And he made a nice, so he said, for clinical trials, we have a sort of really developed inclusion schedule. It, of course, this is very much a laboratory setting. What we do in the practice is a selective referral. It depends a bit on who is your doctor, who is your nurse, what knowledge do they have, what interest do they have in palliative care. And this is a bit relating on the chance to get a referral to palliative care expertise. And this is not how it should be, but this is the practice often. And what we maybe need is a need-based referral, coupled with maybe a sort of screening. We have the screening of the surprise question. We are sort of experimenting with that. Not sure if this is the final one, but at least it helps to get an eye on who is your patient population. And then you can also make a policy or a treatment plan around that. And at this moment, this is still often underserved, I think. Number nine, the cultural iceberg. There is a difference in what is written on paper and what is happening in practice. And I would try to illustrate that with the cultural iceberg. So we have our technology, we have our structures, we have our medical agreements, who is in the lead for which patient, who is not in the lead. We have, you also have the whole legislation around it. What are informed consent about the obligations of the professional. We have agreements or about what finances do we have for palliative care in the hospital or in the home or in the hospice. But below the level, there's a whole thing about the beliefs and the assumptions. What do we think about palliative care? Are we really agreeing on the purposes that we want to strive for? Or is someone still in the curative modus and the other one is already in the care modus and it doesn't really come together? So then at the first sight we agree, but at the further discussion we don't really agree. And so there's a lot going on that the values that we share or don't share. And basically we want the best for the patient, but how it can be achieved, there are a lot of different views on that sometimes. And this is what I mean with the cultural iceberg. And also sometimes late referrals can be a bit related to that because someone thinks I can treat this patient with palliative care. I read something about palliative care and now I know enough of that. This is what we quite hear a lot. I did already many patients. I never had a complaint, so it will be okay. But also positively, I want to be there for my patient. And if he needs me, I will be there for him or her. And then what is below that are all these values about how you look at what is good care. And this is what we also saw in our study, that And I think it's something to take into account. And the last one, integration is a verb. It's maybe a bit a Dutch sentence, but at least it means that we need to work on it. We have education to do. We have research to do. But also we have to connect inpatient level and community levels. And I think this community level is getting more and more important, not only the primary care, but also the social care. And I think we need to think where the patient is in his local situation, in what is the household situation, are there children around who can care or not at all? It makes quite a big difference. Is there a partner? Is there not a partner? but also, at the broader point of view, what is the neighborhood? Is there a sort of support to be expected from the neighborhood? Is it a rural setting? Is it a city? So this community level also makes a lot of difference in what you can do actually and what you can expect from the care provided. And I think these connections can be built much stronger in general. And it's still also a bit relating for me to this whole idea of passionate communities, which you can think about how the community can support, let's say, death and dying, which sometimes still is a bit at the edge of our society, but how we can involve that much more and make it a sort of natural discussion and also a natural process. And also then it comes less as a surprise for family members, and also the education of family members is very important there. So also these sort of strategies are there. So these connections can be made much stronger. Also, what is exactly the demand of the need of our population in relation to what we want to achieve? So I think many questions circle around this sort of little drawing that I made. I think basically we should keep an eye on who is the patient in front of us, what are the needs of these patients, who is the family member, who is the caregiver, who is the informal caregiver, what kind of different expertises are needed. And I'm sure you have very good experiences with that, but I think you all know that many things can be improved. So my last slide would be, integrated palliative care, is it a mission possible or impossible? I think it's possible, but it doesn't come by itself. But I hope that we can all make good progress with that in the coming years. Thank you.